Now turn to the last case on this morning's docket. That is case number 108097 in the matter of Craig E. Collins.
May it please the court, Stan Hazlett appearing for the Disciplinary Administrator's Office. I would like to reserve 2 minutes for rebuttal.
2 minutes is granted.
We're here as a result of a hearing that occurred on January 25th of 2012, at which the respondent appeared pro se. On March 28th of 2012, the final hearing report was signed and released. The hearing panel in that case recommended a one-year suspension with a reinstatement hearing under Supreme Court Rule 219. Our recommendation was the same. The respondent filed exceptions to the findings made by the panel, and briefs have been filed, and we're here for oral argument. The respondent raises 6 issues in his brief. I want to briefly address each one of those issues. The first issue deals with the findings made by the panel regarding the respondent's trust account and the overdrafts that were written on the respondent's trust account. And we received a number of overdraft notifications under Supreme Court Rule 1.15 that banks generate once a lawyer writes a bad check on his or her trust account. The panel found, well, first of all, let me make clear that we're not talking about conversion of client funds here. That's not what happened in this case. There were no client funds in the trust account. That was the respondent's position, and that's what the records show. There were small amounts of money in the trust account, like $3, $6, which was that money belonged to the respondent. The panel found that Rule 1.15A was violated due to the fact the respondent had those personal funds in his trust account. They also found that Rule 8.4G, which prohibits conduct which adversely reflects on a lawyer's fitness to practice, was violated because the respondent acknowledged in his testimony that he wrote the checks on his trust account knowing that there were not sufficient funds in the trust account to cover the checks. The checks were for a variety of purposes. A CLE, they were for to the CLE Commission. There were 2 occasions when the checks were sent to the clerk of the appellate court's office to pay for attorney registration fees and the late fees, which totaled $275. I think it's pretty clear and uncontroverted that those 2 rules were violated. But I would like to address the respondent's argument with respect to his trust account. He argued at the panel hearing that it was okay to use his trust account for personal use so long as there were not client funds in the trust account. And what he did here, what he said he was going to do, but it went awry, was he wrote the checks on his trust account with the expectation that he was going to be able to collect some fees owed to him by clients, and he would be able to put the money back in his trust account prior to the time that the checks were presented for payment to be honored. Well, of course, he wasn't able to collect the money from the clients, and he wasn't able to put the money back in the trust account, so the checks were not honored by the bank. And the trust account overdraft notifications were sent to our office. I think it's obvious and common knowledge that this is not a permissible use of the trust account. 1.15D prohibits a lawyer from placing a lawyer's money in the trust account or the lawyer's firm in the trust firm's money in the trust account that the lawyer's already earned. Obviously, the proper use of a trust account would be to remove earned fees once they're earned, or there's no dispute over those fees. But there's no provision, obviously, that would allow a lawyer to place earned fees back into the trust account to pay for items not related to a client transaction. With respect to the second issue,
Mr. Hazlett,
yes.
Let me see if I understand. Are you saying 1.15D prohibits placing earned fees back into the trust account?
Yes, if you look, Your Honor, if you look at D1, it says at the bottom, it says, and no funds belonging to the lawyer or the law firm shall be deposited therein, except as follows. So, I mean, typically what happens, I mean, you put a like an advance fee and you take it out when you earn it, or you put a settlement check in there, and once you learn there's no dispute over the fee that you've earned, if you get 30% of it, you take it out. And then you distribute it to your client. But in no instance could you place earned fees back in the trust account, and I think that's what D1 says. Second issue, the respondent argued in his brief that the panel improperly applied ABA standard 4.1 in coming to its conclusion as to the appropriate discipline. 4.1 deals with safekeeping of property, but it was not a standard cited by the panel in its panel report. So they cited 4.42, which has to do with diligence issues, and 7.2, which has to do to do with obligations to the legal profession, which was the lack of cooperation issue that was here. 4.1 was not cited in the panel report. Issue number three, did the respondent violate Rule 8.1 and Supreme Court Rule 207, both of which require cooperation in the investigation of a disciplinary complaint? The evidence was that in the six overdraft situations where we sent out letters asking for his response, that there was never a timely response. Then we docketed the complaint for investigation. There was not a timely response to the letter that went out asking for a response. The testimony at the hearing was that he didn't give it the attention that he thought he should have. The respondent didn't, because there was no compromise of client funds. It was rather, I would suggest, a cavalier attitude when you're talking about an investigation with our office. And I think the evidence is clear that the respondent did not cooperate in a timely fashion. The next issue has to do with the weight and credibility to be given the witness's testimony. And here we're talking about the second complaint. And this was a couple named the Haynes who had retained the respondent to file their tax returns for them. And what the panel concluded was that the Haynes testimony was more credible than the respondent's on the issue of whether the Haynes provided information necessary to complete the taxes. The respondent took the position that they had not provided the information necessary for him to complete the taxes. The panel had the ability to observe the witnesses and evaluate their demeanor, which is what they're supposed to do under the law, and that's what they did, and they determined that the Haynes testimony was more credible than that of the respondent.
Would that have been based in part upon the other lawyer's testimony, that based upon the information they had provided, he was able to have completed and filed the returns?
In fact, Your Honor, that was the next thing I was going to say. Their testimony was corroborated by the fact that Mr. Sosowski said that as soon as he received the information from the Haynes, he was able to quickly prepare the tax return. So there was, not only did they observe their demeanor, but they had this, I think, pretty powerful corroborating evidence that the Haynes said, you know, we went over his house, we got the information, the tax information we had given to him. We took it to Mr. Sosowski, who pretty quickly then prepared the taxes. The fifth issue deals with the exclusion of some exhibits. There was a motion that was filed with the court earlier on after the panel report had been docketed, asking that three exhibits should be admitted to the record or added to the record, two of which I didn't object. The third was the Haynes 2001 tax return. And I look back through the record, and that tax return, although there was mention made of it, it was never offered by the respondent. So I objected to the fact that to the inclusion of a document that was never even offered at the hearing. The last issue, the respondent takes exceptions to the findings of Rule 1.3, diligence, and 8.4G, which is prohibits conduct adversely reflecting on the respondent's fitness to practice. And again, this has to do with the failing to diligently file the Haynes tax returns. I mean, here you have the evidence of the Haynes, both of the Haynes testimony, which was consistent. And again, you have the testimony of Mr. Sosowski, who said that, you know, once I received this information, the tax returns were not that complex to do, and it took me about 40 hours to do these 10 years worth of tax returns. Actually, it wasn't 10. It was 8, I think, but he said he was able to do it relatively quickly, which, you know, the respondent had that information for 10 years and didn't file the taxes. So I think that that finding made by the panel is certainly backed up by clear and convincing evidence. Finally, I would say, with respect to our recommendation for discipline, standard 4.42 cited by the panel states that suspension is appropriate where a lawyer engages in a pattern of neglect and causes an injury or potential injury to a client. Well, if you read the panel report, you will see that the Haynes took the position that they sustained substantial monetary damage in the amount of about $21,000 due to the expenses related to the seizure of their property, as well as the inability to collect refunds which would have been due to them, because after a certain passage of time, you can't collect the refunds. So there is the damage to the clients, and the panel also cited standard 7.2, which deals with your obligations to the profession and to the legal system. And there they were talking about the fact that the respondent didn't cooperate in the investigation and provide timely responses. Under those circumstances, I think a year suspension is appropriate. And I think the evidence would show that there needs to be a reinstatement hearing to see if the respondent can prove to this court by clear and convincing evidence that this type of thing would not happen again.
What kind of evidence would you anticipate in that regard?
That the respondent would present? I think there needs to be evidence. The respondent represented himself. I would hope that at a reinstatement hearing, he would not make what I consider to be a mistake again. I think there needs to be some evidence that the respondent is emotionally able to deal with the stresses of everyday practice. Those would be the things I would be looking for.
Is it your view, based on the evidence, that that is an undercurrent to explain some of this conduct?
I can't help from what I've seen and what I've seen in the past over the years that's an issue here. I mean, I asked that question. It's in the record. There was a denial, but I still can't help but feel that that's an issue.
Do we have any further questions of counsel? Thank you, counsel.
Okay, thank you.
May it please the court, Craig Collins, respondent, appearing pro se. Your Honors, I believe I'd like to address the 1.15 issue first. Mr. Hazlett stated that it's obvious that the use of the lawyer's trust account when there are no client or third-party funds is a violation of 1.15. Yet, in petitioner's brief, there was no cases cited that showed that such a situation had been found previously to be a violation, and I know I have not found any cases and believe it to be a case of first impression. In the respondent's brief, as far as addressing the different language or the wording in 1.15D1, which is the operative language, there is a comparison between the Kansas statute and that's on page 25, and what the Georgia court uses. And the distinction is Georgia's 1.15B is a straight prohibition. No personal funds shall ever be deposited in a lawyer's trust account except enough that for basically case expenses, which is our 1.15 D1 allows, which the hearing panel actually found as what I had violated. With $3 in the account and with $6 in the account, that it was because I had personal funds in my trust account. And that is specifically authorized by our 1.15 D1. And I would certainly disagree and request this court to not hold that as a proper conclusion of the law. As to the overdraft and its impact on the practice of law, or the, I believe the one point, the trust account issue is actually a two-part or a bifurcated type of issue. One, is it improper for an attorney, if there was funds in the account, in that hypothetical, to use the account? If it's an absolute prohibition, it makes no difference whether there was an overdraft or not. The second part, is it because there was an insufficient fund check, or as counsel pointed, those that had some to had been presented twice, is that as far as impacting on the practice of law? Ironically, in the court's rules, 208G3, it actually anticipates an insufficient funds check. So I don't believe that this is on the payment of registration fees. So I don't necessarily agree with counsel that the issue itself of a no-funds check written to the clerk of the Kansas Supreme Court is a reflection on the ability to practice law.
Sir,
when this court has...
Counsel, excuse me, counsel, that was only two of the six, wasn't it?
Yes, the 275. The first was a situation, and that was not a check. It was a situation that I had attempted to be accommodating. This was with a client who did not have funds at the time, was receiving multiple robocalls from actually the U.S. Bank call center, and was told that if there was an account, that they would pull that out of the queue, and she would not be getting the calls. After sending in, forwarding the authorization, or my contacting them and forwarding authorization so that I could deal with them, I provided my trust account routing number and account number, and the understanding that as soon as client deposited the funds, I would call and authorize them to process the payment. They went ahead and processed it, did not know they were going to process it. I had no anticipation on my part or intent to make the payment. It, at the time, I believe the first one was $6. It resulted in a $23 charge. I made a deposit to cover that, brought the balance up to $6. I contacted them again, and they said, well, you know, we'll correct it, but it had processed the second time. And so that was not authorized, was not intended, and that was two of the six. The next was to the Kansas Bar Association. I was needing to get CLE, and contacted client to see if I could would be able to get funds, because they had one of their all-day video presentations, and yes, I could. So this was on a Saturday, so I attended, went to collect it, and was not able to get it. So on Monday, I went to the bank, made a deposit, issued a stop payment, and since it was a starter check, and the young lady wrote the amount down wrong, the electronic or the computer processing did not catch it.
Counsel, forgive me for interrupting.
Mm-hmm.
Mr. Hazlett has requested that your license be suspended for a year.
Yes.
And you have about 7 minutes left to explain to us why we should not do that. And I'm just asking, are you preparing to recite every one of the alleged discrepancies in the report, because that's going to support your argument that we should not suspend for a year, or where are we heading with this? I want to make sure you use
certainly
the right use of your time.
No, I was responding to Her Honor's question as far as the one check. Again, none of the checks were, as far as the knowing, yes, at the time there was not, the money was not in the account, but the intent was that it would be deposited. Petitioner's brief stated that one of the circumstances was that my father had been ill, and at the time of the reinstatement, which was previously at the end of September, that was just 3 days after my father we'd had his memorial service, and I'd come back to Topeka to take care of that, and then I went home for family business. So there was that was the purpose. The transcript, I believe, is explains what the other circumstances were involved. But again, the use of the trust account is kicked in when there are client or third party. When there is not, it is not a prohibited act. Regarding the...
Mr. Collins, what is not clear about the words, no funds belonging to the lawyer or law firm shall be deposited therein?
It is the first, as you read the beginning with D, preserving the identity of the funds, it is the first part of that sentence before the and is the presumption that there are client or third-party funds in. And if that is the situation, there is no ability to do that, if or for the attorney to do that. But if there are not client funds, there is no prohibition, as opposed to, like I say, what the Georgia 1.15 is an absolute no use account. So, but our trust account language is that once there are trust or a client or third party funds, then there can be no attorney's fees other than the de minimis amounts. On the tax issues, the transcript and the final report, hearing report, I'm not sure that the presiding officer wrote it, because she had asked a number of questions of Mr. Taskowski regarding the preparation of the returns, but significantly the issue of when they were completed and the circumstances prior to the seizure on April 28th. Mr. Taskowski had testified that he had picked the returns up from Mrs. Haynes on first week of January. Actually, it had been January 3rd, that it took him a short time to do them, but certainly by mid-February, all the returns were complete and the Haynes had them. And in March, and this was questioned by the chair, did you caution Mr. Haynes, which is whose name the tax warrant was in, about needing to get them filed? Yes. They still weren't filed. So The returns were completed and in the Haynes' hand over 70 days from the time they were picked up from me until seizure was 115 days. The issue of the tax years that petitioner has in the report and what is in the final hearing report are slightly different. Petitioner has 2000 tax year as being one that was not prepared. That had been prepared and refund received. The tax year 2001 had been prepared and signed by the clients, and they'd asked me to hold it as because they were going to come up with or hopefully come up with more deductions. They had a little over $8,000 in tax liability.
Excuse me, counsel.
Mm-hmm.
You have 2 minutes left.
Yes.
And I don't want to dictate to you how you use your time, but I would like to hear from you what you would like for us to do about your case before you sit down.
Certainly. The diligence as to preparing the returns, having prepared the 03, the 04, and that the testimony of Mr. Sikowski that the 07 and 08 had not been provided, there was no lack of diligence. The transcript would show that what I had put in my response was accurate. Your Honor, I certainly would request that the court find that there was not a lack of diligence, but as far as the if there is a sanction, I would request that the court allow me to continue the cases that I have. If it would require supervision, I would certainly think that would be appropriate. I have a concern that a sanction is even more detrimental to clients than even myself, and I would request again, if sanctions are imposed, that the court consider allowing me to continue the cases that I have.
How many cases do you have? And what are they?
Probably about 15. Right now, I have a Jerry's Bike Shop case up.
I'm sorry, what?
Jerry's Bike Shop case here in Topeka, which has been ongoing now since 2006. If I could submit to the court those cases, I would.
But you have about 15 cases. They're civil cases generally?
Correct, yes.
Thank you.
Yeah. Your Honor, I realize I'm out of time.
I have a question, counsel, before you sit down. Have you submitted at any point in this process a probation plan?
No. No, okay. I did not.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Do you have a recommendation for us on sanctions, as you put it? You've said you'd have no problem with being allowed to finish your cases or being under supervision. Do you have something concrete for us to consider?
In reviewing previous cases, I know that if I should have submitted certainly any proposal well in advance, and I have not done that or put it together. But if I may, I could put that together very quickly and submit it as consideration to Mr. Haslam to the court.
I think we're a little late.
No, I understand that. My understanding.
All right. Do we have any other questions of counsel? I see none. Thank you, counsel.
Thank you.
You can reserve 2 minutes for rebuttal.
I would waive rebuttal, Your Honor, unless the court has any questions for me.
We have any questions of counsel? I see none. Thank you both for the arguments this morning and for 3 minutes this afternoon. The court will take this matter under advisement. That concludes this morning's docket. The court is in recess until 9 o'clock tomorrow morning.